And I'd like to thank you for inviting me to the workshop, and I'm sorry I cannot go. My topic today is about Chu and Zula, the two terms you are all very familiar with. Here are the explanations by modern scholars, by modern dictionaries. But in the old Tibetan texts related to the Tibetan kings, especially in the phrases in praising the glory of the kings such as this, the above explanations are just not right. Now, a variety of interpretations have been provided by scholars, first by McDonald, then by Stein, and Han, and Wang Xiaoying, and Michael, and the most recent one is published in 2018 by Bailey. And I know you are all aware of them, so I will not go into detail of this. In what follows, I will my interpretations, and I would like to propose that both Chu and Zula are the equivalent of Chinese Confucian concept Li. Now, it was Stein who first in 1992 introduced us to these two old Tibetan manuscripts, PT987 and PT98. He said that there are two examples of the same text, and this text is an account of wise maxims from Chinese Confucianism, but he had not been able to identify the citations. However, Stein's he said certain Tibetan terms such as Chu and Zhe, which ought to have the particular meaning of a specific Chinese word. And he proposed that Chu would be the equivalent of Dao and Zhejiang of De. However, Stein's identifications are proved to be not acceptable. In 2005, a Chinese scholar Ni Hongying found the citations of PT988, and he pointed out that the manuscript derived mainly from Tai Kung Jia Jiao, a work intended for the instruction of children in ancient China, especially in Tang and Song period. Now, this is a sentence from the manuscript, and let's see the my transliteration much clearer. This sentence it says, Chema Yimbala Migi Gang Mi Lo Kaya Mi Mao. And Stein translate all choosing it as principle. Can you hear it?
Yeah.
Actually, the sentence is from Tai Kung Jia Jiao, and Tai Kung Jia Jiao again is from Analects of Confucius from Lun Yi. In the chapter 12 of the book, has this sentence, Fei Li Wu Si, Fei Li Wu Ting, Fei Li Wu Yan, Fei Li Wu Dong. If it is not accordance with proper rights, I do not check it, look at it, and etc., etc. So, Chu should interpret it as Li proper rights. By the way, Zhe is the equivalent of Yi, but I will not go into it because it's not the topic of today. Now, there's one case. Another case came out in 2017 when Sa Ji and Sa Ren Gaowa identified a Dunhuang Tibetan manuscript from Natamula collections, the teaching of ancient Taigong. The manuscript has close relation with PT988. Many sentences of the two overlap. Tai Kung Jia Jiao is its main source, but there are citations from other Chinese classics such as Analects, Book of Rites, Book of Fatal Pact, Book of Changes, etc. The passage we just cited is in the new manuscript. Here I copied another sentence that contains the word Li proper rights. Here it says, Chi Gi Nian Du Tona Tui Na Le Ben Ken Bu Yi Kan Du Le Du Zhu Wei Chi Yue Dou temple. The sentence is from Taigong Jiajiao, Li Wen Lai Xue, Bu Wen Wan Jiao. Thus, I heard according to proprietary students go for learning, but not teachers come for teaching. So again, Chue is the equivalent of Li. Now, I want to use the meaning Li to translate the word Chue in some old Tibetan texts. When describing their ancestor Qi temple came into Tibet as the lord of Tibet of people, it says the people there, Que San Du Qi, practicing good rites. This is a passage from the Western inscription at Xie Lakan. When Qide Sun Zhang decided to bestow his favor to the monk Niang Ding Ejin, he said, recompense for a contribution is the proper right in bestowing favor. Another one. The chapter 3 of the Old Tibetan Chronicle tells how the king of Yanbu, Xinbu Jie Da Jie Wu, was wrong in all his action. It says he reversed the proper rights and changed the government affairs. The Lord did all wrong things. Then his minister Yan Ding, Jisong Nabu begged, because Lord did all things in the reverse, in the wrong direction. Our governmental affairs are not like the governmental affairs. Proper rights are not like the proper rights. So what wrong it is? Now sometimes Chue combines with Lu, referring to Li, all those related to Li, such as rites and customs, ritual ceremony, etc. Here is a sentence from the old Tibetan Sansu, in which the king Wu gave his command to his soldiers and stated how the king Zhou Hou San did all wrong things, and Zhou's uncle Bi Gan criticized him. He said, the action like this against the right and the custom is improper. Again, in the chapter 4 of the old Tibetan Sansu, the king Wu gave his command to his soldiers and stated that the king chose evil doings, and he said he behaved improper against the right and the custom. Thus, both without and within the kingdom, only falseness and cunning were practiced, and the subjects have been tyrannized. Now, I demonstrate that Chue is the equivalent of Li in what follows. I would like to show that Zula is also the equivalent of the same Chinese word. As we all know, in a number of old Tibetan texts, Chue often makes a pair with Zula, Zhu or Zula, written as Chue or Chue Lu San and Zhu Te or Zula Te, though the order may be inverted. Stein once pointed out that the two terms seem to be sometimes equivalent, sometimes slightly different but related. In terms of the classical Chinese grammar, it is Hu Wen. Maybe my English translation is wrong, but it is definitely Hu Wen. For Zula, Stein once pointed out that it refers to the political or administrative institutions or good conduct. The interpretation is right, I think is right. However, he did not find the exact Chinese word for it, and I believe it is Li. Now, let's turn again to the old Tibetan Sansu. This is the chapter of accomplishment of military actions, just Wu Cheng, in which the king Wu decided to abandon weapons after they won the war against the Sun Kingdom, and he ordered, just he ordered, this is my translation. The weapons were all laid down, and he ordered that hereafter Zula, together with the calligraph and the mathematics, be practiced and learned. And then he set free at the place Hua San the horses needed for offensive expeditions and release the cattle in the forest of Baoling. Now, let's look at the original Chinese text. Here, you see some words are large and some words are smaller. So the larger words are supposed to be the original scripture of Sanzu, and the smaller words are supposed the interpretations, the notes made by Kongbanguo, Confucius of Han dynasty. It says, Nei Yan Wu Xiu Wen, it means abandon weapons and building culture. And let's start the big words first. Then it says, Hui Ma Yin Hua San Zi Yang Fan Yu Yi Tao Li Zi Yi, which means set free the horse at the north of Hua San, and set free the cattle at the forest of Baoling. And then, Shi Tian Xia Huo Fu means to show all the people and heaven that the horses and the cattle will not be used anymore. But the Tibetan text does not translate it. Now let's turn to the Tibetan text again. Apparently, the second part, which I marked with purple, is a translation of Hui Ma Yi Hua San Zi Yang Fan Yu Yi Tao Lin Zi Ye, is the exact translation, almost exact. But the first part we see is not the translation of Yan Wu Xiu Wen. Yan Wu Xiu Wen means to give up the weapon and to building up culture, to develop culture. It's not the translation of Yan Wu Xiu Wen. Let's look at the Chinese text. It's translating the smaller words. Do you see smaller words? Dai gang ge bao yu hu bi si bu yong xing li shi shi xian xi xiu wen jiao. So bao zai gang ge is the exact translation of zai jian nan ji nen ne. Now, coupling translated nen as putting away, but it's not putting away. It's lying down the all weapons. But there's no translation for bao yu hu si bu yong, which means the weapons were covered with skins or tiger, indicating no use anymore, but no translation for this Chinese word. Then, xing li shi shi qian xu wen jiao, which means to practice li shi, to set up school and to develop education. So, and I think, let's look at the Tibetan words again. And I believe zhu la jue is a translation for xing li zhe, and yi ji le is what the se xing qi xiu wen jiao for. So I believe zhu la is the translation of li zhe. Then what is li zhe? In ancient China, a perfect gentleman, a jinzi, was required to master the six arts, and the archery was one of them. The art of archery was the competitive sport of using a bow to shoot arrows according to certain standards. It believed that in ancient China, all noblemen had to master the skill. After the death of the Sun, the king who believed there would be no war anymore. So he ordered the people to practice Li Shi. Li Shi means the archery according to certain rites instead of the archery simply for fighting like before. Now, after the war, the king Wu decided to lay down the weapons and to build culture, which shows that the king wanted his people thereafter having knowledge in calligraphy and the proper rights. He hoped his people were well educated in culture but not in fighting. Therefore, I would go further and propose that in all Tibetan people's understanding, Zula actually means Li. So, and the word Zula appears three times in the old Tibetan Sanzu. Now I would like to demonstrate that the interpretation Li is well suited to all three cases. One is in lines 130 to 34 of the chapter of sorry, why? In which the king who stayed, let's see my translation. I treat the prince with reverence to ministers having obtained 10, and with these ministers I have respectfully preserved the principle of heaven, and then cut off those disorderly roads. Our kingdom, unlike the others, is great and possessed of proprieties, the barbarians, etc. All the kingdoms have gathered under my sway and respectively heed my commands. Here, I translate Namgyu as the principle of heaven, which is the highest one of the proprieties, and I will return back to this soon. Now, another one is in lines 31 to 35, in which the King Wu sworn with his soldiers to fight with the sun, and he said, you're no more man who duel in the western regions, because you clearly know the principle of heaven, so keep you clearly throughout the custom of good and evil and the legal statute, etc. The King of Yin Zhou did not practice the custom of failure, respect and honesty and the five kinds of principles, and he did not think respectively of the proprieties, the spirits, the dead ancestors, and etc. of the former generations of the ancestors. Now this passage has a similar sentence in lines 78 to 80 of the Old Tibetan Tao. So comparing the two, we can see that the Zula has a similar meaning as Namsa here, because it says Namsa Tan Hula Tan Xiu, but here is Zula Tan Hula Tan Gongzhen, so it's same meaning. Zula has a similar meaning as Namsa, referring to the principle of heaven and earth, i.e. the law of nature. Now I would like to explain a little bit more of this, why I translate Namgyu's principle of heaven. The scholars on Confucianism tell us that the basic principle of Li is to imitate the heaven. In one chapter of Book of Rites, it says, rise is the order of heaven and earth. In another chapter, it says, the principle of proper rise is to follow the order of the heaven and earth, and etc. And it says, anyone who criticizes this is ignorant of origin of the proper rise. In other words, the nature of the proper rise is to show the order of the heaven and earth. So the Zula that the King Zhou did not respect is equivalent to Namgyu or Namsa, the highest one of the proper rights. In concluding of this part lecture, Zula can be interpreted as the, as well as those related to Li, such as ritual system, rights and regulations, because the two words have the same or similar meanings, they are often used in Huwen. So, and in this report, I will translate Chu as proprieties and Zula proprieties. Now I would like to give more examples, and I find the interpretation of Zula as Li is well suited in all these texts. Here is from the chapter 9 of the Old Tibetan Chronicle, which stated in the time of Chideyuza, the envoys of Lanzhou Kingdom went to the Tibetan court to pay their due tribute and to express their intention to submit to the Tibetan authority. There, the Tibetan lord and the ministers together sang a song. It says, when first the son of God, Lord of Men, went to the plains of Tibet, there, because the rice are good and the propriety is great, so he gathered all kingdoms. Thought an admirable revered father thought the son of God example. His propriety is great, his rice good, and his administration agreeable. His command just and his word constant. So the kingdom of the king of Lanzhou offered his reward. The next chapter of the same manuscript is to praise the glory of Xuzong Dezhang, and it says during that time, his rights were good and his government great. The king lived in the land between the two, i.e. the heaven and the earth, acting as lord and master of both the upright men and the stupid animals. His propriety was great, rightly conducted as an example for women. Now sometimes Chu and Zula appear together and I understand it as the best rights. This is the inscription at the Chongjie Bridge. The long stone was set up to praise the glory of Xuzong Dezhang, but at the beginning of the inscription, it first praises the royal ancestors, and it says, when the gods assembled, the ancestors came as lords of gods and men. Their rights were superior and their custom good. Their status were firm and their splendor great. Now this manuscript, the prayer for the foundation of the Gayutai Monastery, is from the Chizhu Dezhang period, in which it prays the temple as this: His Majesty is Lord, Son of God, a God acting as a God of human, therefore possesses the divine powers in his mind. Practicing extensively the superior and the good rights of God, his companion prays all under heaven. Now, sometimes Chu and Zula can be preceded by Nam or Namsa. This, I believe, is to indicate that it is right in accordance with the highest natural law and can be translated as the principle of heaven or the principle of heaven and earth. Again, the inscription at the Chongjie Bridge, our bridge in the ancestors. The text goes to praise the king Xuzong Dezhang, and it says, likewise, his majesty is the god king Xuzong Dezhang, in accordance with the ritual of the ancestors, did not endure the proprieties of gods, but acted in harmony with the principle of heaven and earth. The beginning of the inscription is the tomb of the Songzhang Red. As this, let's look at my translation. When the temple son of God, the Dui Pu Jie, came down from the God in heaven as Lord of men, his rights and custom were good and never did his proprieties change. His authority was mighty and never was his splendor damaged. His government became greater and greater, his status was forever firm. In accordance with the eternal great proprieties, the Son of God, Chide Songzhang, acted as Lord of men. In agreement with the rituals of God, his authority was mighty and like unto the principle of heaven. His commands were powerful, and etc., etc. Now, in this case, Ha and Namsa can be replaced by Cha with the similar meaning. The chapter 13 of the Old Tibetan Chronicle has a song sent by the king Chidusong against the Da family, and it says, oh, in the beginning, in ancient times, first the start, the proprieties were established, well established. Then he says, do men ride horses or horses rather than the one who established the proprieties of Tianos? Does the sickle cut grass, or the grass cut the sickle, etc. And the proprieties of Chia will not change, and the feathers of the arrow will not fall. To sum up so far, Chu and Zula, sorry. Chu and Zula, among many old Tibetan texts concerning the political ideology of Tibetan Empire, were used to translate Confucian conceptually, denoting Li as well as those related to Li, such as rites and reservations, rites, custom, ritual ceremony, ritual system, the principle of heaven, and the principle of heaven and earth. Li is a core concept in Confucianism. The above cited old Tibetan texts all contained worldly, indicating that the Confucian philosophy was once a part of the political ideology of the Tibetans and played a significant role in the making of the Tibetan Empire. So now the last part. Now for the political culture of old Tibetan Empire, scholars have different opinions. Professor Beckwith once proposed it belongs to that of Central Eurasian cultural complex, while Professor Lin Guanqing, a scholar from Taiwan, says that the Tibetan ideology of Son of God is similar to the political philosophy of ancient Chinese Son of Heaven, thus a part of traditional Chinese culture. Examining carefully the cited text, their descriptions of the Tibetan ancestors and the temples are nothing more than two aspects. First is a Son of God came as Lord of men, and secondly, Chisan and Zhu Lishuang. Now, only out these two aspects both never change, then it is in accordance with the proper rights of heaven and earth. Thus, to make the temple's dominion becomes higher, his status becomes firm, and his authority becomes great. For the first part, the idea of the Son of God, which I think it may originate from the Central Eurasian cultural complex as proposed by Professor Beckwith. It was believed that the Tibetan temple were gods and they returned to the heaven after they passed away. This is different with the idea of the Son of Heaven. The Son of Heaven was not a god. An emperor of ancient China had no divinity and would not go to heaven out of passing away. For the second part, Chisan and Zhu Lishuang, I believe, belong to the Confucian philosophy. Thus, it may be safe to say the political ideology of the Tibetan Empire is a combination of the cultures from both the Central Asia and China. But who introduced the Confucian ideology in Tibet and why and when? From limited sources, we know that starting from the time of Song Zhang Tangpo's grandfather, Gabu Yesi, the Tibetans of the Yangtze Valley began to extend their realm. And in the time of his father, Namji Lunzang, they united the places of the plateau. However, according to a record in the old Tibetan chronicle, we do not know what happened in the late days of Namji Lunzang. Anyway, when Song Zhang Tangpo came into throne, most of his subjects deserted, and many tribes turned back, and his father was presented with poison and death. The young Song Zhang Tangpo, though facing chaos, quickly controlled the situation. Then in 644, Xianxiong was brought under his control, thus completely united the whole Tibetan plateau. However, the political unity did not mean cultural harmony at the same time. The kings and ministers of the old kingdom still shared certain political power and were active in the new court of the Tibetan Empire. In view of the turmoil in his father's late days, Song Zhang Tangpo was likely to realize the need for cultural integration, the need to improve the political system, especially to propose a new political theory to legitimize his family's rule. Now, when we say it was Song Zhang Tangpo who built the political culture of the Tibetan Empire, we meet with a huge problem of sources. Among all the old Tibetan documents, the earliest ones with relative clear dates can only went back to the Xisongzhizhan period, so the above speculation is likely to provoke doubt. But in general, when a new dynasty succeeded in unifying its domain, it would face the problem of cultural integration. integration in order to establish the legitimacy of his rule. Taking into account the political situation that Song Zhangbo met with when he first came into throne, he definitely had to do something with the political organization and ideology of his empire after he unified the whole Tibet plateau. Now this is the famous old colonial account. The chapter 12 is about Song Zhangbo. It's about the relation between Song Zhangbo and the God, and it is to praise the glory of Song Zhangbo. It was Wu Rui who first proposed that the manuscript is not necessarily a real record of historical facts. He translated Bergui Zula Katsu Tempo as a great erudite laws of Tibet and Bergui Chu Di Xiong Sambuhun as all the foundations of the Tibetan customs, and pointed out that the manuscript is the first of its kind to attribute the establishment of the legal codes of Tibetan Empire to Song Zhangbo, but because according to old Tibetan annals, the legal code of Tibetan Empire was written by Da Song Zhangbo, so he says it's not right. But here, Zulakachi is not laws and Chu is not customs. I believe Zula Gaqing is equal to Chu Qing in the inscription of the Sino-Tibetan Treaty. It means rights and regulations, but not law. And also, Chu is not customs. This is my translation. So it's very long, but I'd like to read it together. Profound thought above, it was Chi Song Zhang. The wise minister below, it was Song Zhang Yusong. The Lord took the ritual of the chair of heaven's mountains, minister took the customs of the earth, and through this way their authority was great and therefore the best of everything. The government grew abroad in four directions, and the nourishing at home was unreduced and abandoned. The black-headed subjects, high and low, were made even with improper taxation. Being abandoned, they lived at ease. Spring passed like fall, the people enjoyed life as it came and went. Their desires were granted, harms were recognized, violence were prevented, rivals were brought low, slaves were defeated, truth was relied upon, the wise were praised, the brave were venerated, princes were good, royals were good, and the government royalty, and all the people were happy. Though Tibet previously had no letters, it came about at the time of this temple, following which the great proprieties and regulations of Tibet, the order of officials, the powers of the two high and low, rewards for accomplishing the good deeds, punishment for doing deceit, the measurement drawn for fields and to travel pasture and the distance between the way station were all standardized as well. Etc. All the good scriptures of proprieties of Tibet came about during the time of the temple. All the people recollected his kindness and feel it, and thus presented him the name Song Zhangbo. From the text, we see the deeds of Song Zhangbo can be summarized as this. First, the invention of letters, secondly, establishment of the great rules of proprietors, third, arrangement of the high and low orders of officials, and fourth, heating up the regulations for rewarding the good and punishing the bad, and finally, standardized measurement units for the whole kingdom. And I believe these are qualities of Song Zhangbo in social and cultural buildings as the great king of Tibet. The cited text shows that the Lord should have a profound mind and the ministers should be wise. The Lord should perform the rituals of chair of heaven, the ministers should act according to the custom of the earth. In this way, on the promise of the temple of Sun of God, the emperor and the ministers each have their own rights, and their status were distinguished. This is the core of Confucian political doctrine. In one chapter of Analects, the Duke Jing of Qi asked Confucius about government. Confucius replied, "There is government. When the king is king, and the minister is minister, when the father is father, and the son is son. On this, Zhu Xi commanded, this is the base of human affairs, the root of government affairs." The Confucian political philosophy emphasizes the emperor's majesty. It stresses, on one hand, the dignity and the prestige of the monarch, and on the other, the inferior status and the loyalty of the ministers. The reason that the Confucians constructed the ritual system was to establish the ranks and orders between the high and the low, the noble and the humble, the close and the remote, and the senior and the junior. You will remember the chapter 4 of the Old Tibetan Chronicle describes a celebration feast during the time of Namjin Lenzhang, in which Chunghuo, without proper courtesy or minister, sang a song boasting his merits in the expansion of the Yalong tribe. Well, the chapter 12 of the same manuscript records the relation between Songzhang Ganbu and the famous minister Gao Dongzhang Yusong, emphasizing the theme of royalty of subjects. The difference is that out of Songzhang Ganbu's efforts of cultural building, the rise of the up and the low were distinguished. The different status of the monarch and the ministers were recognized, and they were established in the written form of the proper rights. Out of such propaganda, the leaders of other clans could no longer covet the Zhangbo's throne. This is the great contribution of Songzhang Ganbu to the long security of his royal family, and this is exactly why he introduced the Confucian philosophy in Tibet. Now, the final question, when? When he introduced the Confucian ideology into Tibet, then I only found one. According to one record of the old Tang Anu, in the year of 646, when Tang Taitung came back to Chang'an from the war against the Goryeo, Songzhang Ganbu sent his minister Gao to the Tang court, present a huge golden goose and an official letter to Taitung. The letter was preserved in the old Tang Su. It reads, "The holy sun of heaven pacifies the four directions, and the kingdoms illuminated by the sun and the moon all became your majesty's subjects. While Goryeo, relying on their distance, did not perform the proper rites as a subject, the sun of heaven, leading an army of a million men in person, crossed over the Liao River and went to conquer them. The city was captured and the battle formation was destroyed, and the Son of Heaven triumphantly returned back in several days. The barbarians just heard that your majesty was setting off for departure, and in a short time they already heard that your majesty had turned back home. While geese fly fast, yet they are not as swift as your majesty. Humble me as your son-in-law, I'm much happier than ordinary barbarians." As the letter shows, the new theory of the Tibetan kingship might already formulate this time, though in the letter, Songzhang Ganbu did not regard him the one of the barbarians in the borders of the Tang Dynasty. This is my report today. Thank you for all of you.
Okay.